So welcome to the Bus Shelter Bench Advisory Committee meeting. As we do, God, can I forego that since there's nobody in the audience? Can I not give that first little speech? Okay.
You can just call the first citizens participation.
Okay, so first we have citizens participation. Oh, no citizens, okay. So moving on to agenda item number one. Oh, that is agenda item number one, okay. Agenda item number two is approval of the minutes of the meeting February 15th. Has anyone seen them?
Yes.
Anyone have additions or corrections or deletions?
No.
Speak now or forever hold your peace? Okay, so.
Motion to approve.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you, Michael. All those in favor?
Yep.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Moving on to item number three. This is Eileen, because she told me. Item number three is receive a presentation regarding the Regional Transportation Commission of Southern Nevada's 25th.
I know.
How is that possible?
Anniversary.
You know, all this does is make me feel really old.
Well, thank you very much for the introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. For the record, my name is Eileen Magnera. I am the Advertising and Creative Supervisor here at the RTC. So I'm just actually here to share with you, just last December, we had actually celebrated the 25-year anniversary of providing transit service to our valley. And part of that celebration included visiting all of our different bus stops and also to our Bonneville Transit Center, where we had like different giveaways. We partnered with McDonald's to actually give like breakfast items to people on their way to work. And had a fun little day, so I'm going to share with you a quick video just highlighting all the different activities. So again, just kind of highlighting some of the milestones over the last 25 years and some of the accomplishments and a lot of the stats that have to do with not just our transit system, but biking as well. And then, of course, the song featured here is Imagine Dragons, which is like a local, or they're from Las Vegas, so it's kind of fun to include that in there as a good tie-in. And we promoted this all across social media. We also presented this during the board meeting, and we've just been trying to share it as much as possible because we're kind of celebrating all year long. Be happy to answer any questions if anybody has any.
It was awesome. I had no idea that we had the 15th highest ridership in the nation. That surprised
Correct.
Me.
were just ahead of Miami Dade County, because they were like, we're trying to figure out who number 15 is, because we're 16. I'm like, yes.
Wow.
All right, thank you.
I didn't understand some of the numbers there.
The number ones across the board?
Well, so for example, it was 47% fair recovery.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really understand what fair recovery
is. Sure. So in terms of fair recovery, that means like the amount that we're actually able to collect from passenger fares as a person boards. So typically, like just to put it into perspective, the closest to that is what, 23, 20, like about in the 20%, correct?
Well, that's kind of the national average.
The national average.
The national average is 20.
Okay. Perfect. Thanks, Nathan. So in terms of...
So you take the, it was what, $2.29 ridership, and then there was the subsidy amount, so it's 47% would be that equation.
Exactly, yes. So we're collecting almost 50% of the...
Paying attention. So, yeah.
Yes.
And were you actually giving out little orange cone tchotchkes?
Yes, we were. And those are things that we can definitely bring to the next meeting as well. And
I mean, you want one of those, right?
No. Just seemed like an odd sort of traffic to hand out.
Yeah, it's a little traffic cone promoting also our partnership with Waze.
Oh.
So it's the traffic app, and it allows people to be able to mitigate through, you know, different construction areas as well.
Right. Okay.
And it is the perfect symbol of Clark County at the moment.
It is our state flower.
It is the Clark County symbol of progress.
Yeah. Exactly. Code. Jobs, progress, and growth.
Yes.
They pop up like mushrooms every morning.
If only they went away at night, you know. So if you don't know, the number one, you know, first in the nation for fair recovery. So was it on there?
Yep.
I was probably busy writing down 15th for ridership because... and then I heard one day this week, I don't know, that the number of bikes moved on buses has moved up from 50,000 a month to 54,000 a month.
Oh. It has, especially during the better weather. We're definitely getting a lot more bicycles on our buses.
So, you know, you think of a city like Portland that bikes and, you know, I mean, that's such a way of life there. And we move more bikes every month than they do in Portland. So that's, you know, I don't know why I'm shocked about 15th ridership. I've been touting that moving bicycle numbers for a long time because it speaks to our transit users and that are, you know, you saw how many people use transit and bike share. Look at me, you think I work for the RTC? bike share had more than 1 million trips in its first year. It's so impressive.
Yeah, and one of the other fun facts about the million trips is that I think it's like 64 million calories burned.
Yeah, unfortunately, none of those were mine. But I don't know if you've noticed that all bike share racks popping up everywhere.
Yes, so. There's 21 kiosk locations. We actually are planning on swapping out a couple in the next month or so because May is National Bike Month as well. So we're getting ready to kind of move some things around on that.
Where do the stats that are in there, where do those come from? Is there a clearinghouse? We've had the damnedest time finding stats for safety.
Yeah.
Where do we rank? I know we rank 15th in ridership. I mean, is there a place to know where those?
Sure. The number one stats is from the NTD, so the National Transit Database, and they report that annually to the federal government, and that's where we're able to pull those numbers from.
Do they have safety? I mean, is there any knowledge of where we rank safety-wise or accident-wise or anything like that to compare?
That I'm not sure about, but I can definitely look into that.
Yeah.
Any other questions for Eileen?
Thanks.
Thank you. That was very fun.
Yeah,
great.
Thank you.
Okay. So number fourth on the list, try to top number three. Receive an informational presentation regarding the RTC's traffic signal priority project. So Nathan, if it's not set to Imagine Dragons music.
No, it is not. I'm sorry, I don't have.
If I'm gonna hog it, I gotta.
Don't have the fantastic video and everything that goes with it.
They should have had you go before you go first. You know?
Don't lie, I'll hum for you.
All right. Nathan Goldberg, manager of transit planning here at the RTC. Yes, here to talk to you a little bit about a project we have working on Route 202 Flamingo, related to traffic signal priority, or TSP, as it's kind of known in the industry. We're utilizing some of the grant funds that were available for the larger scale project that we did on Flamingo with the dedicated bus lane and the enhanced shelters and repaving and restriping of the whole roadway. Along with that comes some of these technological innovations. So in a nutshell, traffic signal priority is, in simplistic terms, the ability for the bus and the traffic signal to talk to each other back and forth. The technology has upgraded over the years. What we're looking at now, this Opticom system, is GPS-based, real-time information, so that the traffic signal can know it knows if the bus is on time, it knows if the bus is later ahead of schedule, and vice versa as the vehicle moves along the route. So you can basically set it up to understand certain things and set it to say that if the bus is X amount of minutes late, then this traffic signal will do something accordingly to allow the bus to help get it back on time. So this is essentially a diagram of how that works. The bus has a receiver, an emitter, a receiver in it. It speaks to a detector in the traffic signal that's connected into the controller, which is where everything is programmed, and then everything reacts accordingly. So those are being installed. Is it 24 intersections along Flamingo, I believe, is what this is what that equipment looks like in terms of the hardware that's inside the bus. So that all has to be installed in the cabinet that's internal to the vehicle. That's what you would notice if you're driving down the street and you see those little things on top of the traffic signal. That's the receiver that speaks back and forth with the vehicle. Essentially, we're working it out right now in terms of defining what those settings are going to be, talking with all the parties involved. It's a lower level priority than, say, an emergency vehicle would be. Emergency vehicles are able to, they have the same technology in them, but they disrupt essentially they don't care what they do to the traffic pattern, right? The emergency vehicle needs to get through, it changes the light, gets through, does what it needs to do. We don't have that level of priority in terms of being able to disrupt traffic like that, so we're a lower level priority signal. We will be piloting this and then adjusting accordingly in terms of how we see a benefit or how it disrupts traffic. Be happy to take any questions.
So I guess I'm a little confused as the purpose of this. When I first read this, I thought it was to expedite the bus route so that it would be more efficient, quicker to go from stop to stop. But the way that you described it, it sounds more like it's something to keep the buses on time. They got delayed at a stop, and so now we're going to prioritize to get them back on schedule.
Correct. You can do that a variety of ways. As an example, if a bus is 3 minutes late and a signal cycle is 90 seconds long, it can hold up that green to allow the vehicle to go through. Our stops are on the far side generally, so getting through is a big help. That would help the vehicle catch up that 90 seconds. It's still not perfectly on time, but you can adjust those settings. You can basically customize them. And I kind of use, I guess, baby steps along the way here in terms of how it's being done. I know, other communities obviously have some fairly aggressive ways to deal with that, but we're piloting it to see how it goes. But yeah, to your point, right now it would be if the bus is X late, then the signal would do Y.
No, I'm aware. When the first systems came out to get priority to emergency vehicles, they were available for private vehicles. How secure is this system where somebody can't override it and use it for their own?
Yeah, it's a secure, limited, limited area connection. And the nice thing about this compared to some of the old is it's a two-way communication. So you don't just have to have the TSP device on your car. You'd have to have the whole system that goes with it that he showed in the picture, because it has to be a two-way connection. We've seen a lot of real solid developments in transportation recently in terms of technology TSPs have been around for a while, but the problem with them is when they're on, they're on. And while that's appropriate for an emergency vehicle, you can see in the FAST Center, and they've caught people who've illegally had TSPs installed on their cars, because you can see the ripple effect of the impacts on traffic. So the nice thing about this one, and we've dabbled with this technology before, Nathan and his team, they do a great job advocating for transit and moving transit. The thing that's different about this one is that two-way communication, so that when the bus is running late, it will get some advantages, lower-level advantages at the signal, either a shorter red or a longer green, you know, that help get that bus back on time. But when the bus is on time and doesn't need it, then it doesn't do anything, which means we're not interfering with traffic for no reason.
Right. Yeah, it's not, as an example, Seattle has preemption. So as the bus approaches a signal, it turns the signal green as it approaches. But we don't, you know, a lot of routes that have, like in Seattle, they're running 2-minute headways. There's a bus every 2 minutes. So we're not at that level of transit here. As Carl mentioned, what we're looking at is if the bus is late, to try to get it back on schedule.
I would say that's kind of a chicken or the egg thing, because if we were, and the buses had priority like that, that would be a big incentive to take the bus, because you could actually get to your destination faster. So it's, boy, and I could just hear engineers all across the community screaming loudly at that.
Within this very building, you would hear, I mean, just like the rest of the community, we've got some real differences in preference on how we get around.
Totally.
And if you're a car driver, you're like, I want that light green for me. Forget the bus.
And unfortunately, right now, that's the majority of our transportation. I was going to joke about drifting off the back of the bus to try to get more greens, but with my luck, I'd be behind the bus that's on time. And
Well, we do run 90% on time, so...
Yeah, you don't have to say that sheepishly. I don't run on time 90% of the time.
What about the intersections where they cross? I mean, 202 is an east-west route.
Right.
108, for example, gets to the airport. People count on that to be on time.
Sure, exactly. And that's part of what the pilot is meant to watch, is what does this do, you know, if you're giving 3, 4, 5 extra seconds to one side, what does that do to the other? In terms of the traffic patterns and how that all functions, we'll be learning that along the way, and that's part of what this pilot program is meant to help us with, basically to see how aggressive or non-aggressive we can be in terms of shifting that culture.
Is there an ability to turn it off at a particular intersection when we know the bus is coming from the other way?
There's abilities to turn it on and off at certain times of day. I mean, it's basically fully customizable in terms of what you can do. That's the benefit of this system versus the older systems that Carl was alluding to, where it literally is a switch. It's on or it's off. Each intersection can be fully customizable. And you know, you can be more aggressive at one intersection versus the other. And I think that's kind of been some of our conversations, is a primary arterial intersection, such as, say, Flamingo and Decatur, versus one of the shopping center lights in the middle. You can be a little bit more aggressive on one of those shopping center lights because of the lower volume of traffic than you would be at, say, a primary arterial intersection.
So has this been implemented?
It's in process right now. The equipment's being installed. The equipment on the buses, I believe, is completely installed. The equipment in the signal cabinets is not 100% installed yet. They're working their way through all those signal cabinets and getting all that set up. And then it'll be a matter of troubleshooting each one before we can kind of go live. Couple months, probably.
Yeah, I think we'll see. So we had some grant funding left over from the Flamingo project, and so that $300,000-$400,000, something like that, was how we funded this pilot. And the buses was easy because we did it all internally. The intersections, we're having to partner with each of the entities that controls the signals along that route, which is, you know, Clark County, NDOT. So we're having to work with a contractor and their staffs as well.
So how long is the pilot planned to go?
Well, I mean, we're just going to continue monitoring it, and we'll find out what that, I mean, that, obviously, the equipment is essentially installed at that point. It's just a matter of watching, observing what happens.
I guess I was just thinking that if this is a pilot, you typically run a pilot for a period of time, looking for a specific, you know, answers to certain questions, so you could then go back and revise and implement further.
And one thing that FAST, our traffic signal, that wing of the RTC, they were adamant that when you turn this on, you're going to know very quickly. You know, sometimes within hours, you can see what the impacts are on traffic and adjust accordingly. So we'll be, like I said, we'll be working with them to figure out exactly what those settings should be at various hours of the day to maximize our benefit without harming.
Do you have a success criteria? Like, how would you know that this was successful and that you like it and that it's good and we should do it somewhere else? Is there some sort of criteria you've laid out that
sure.
says?
There's two things. One, the company that we're getting this from, Opticom, they have reports that they send us in terms of they'll be able to tell us all the data. How many times did a bus request priority at each intersection? So you'll be able to get that information. And from my end of it, from the transit planning and transit operations team's perspective, I'm looking at our daily and weekly and monthly on-time performance reports. I want to see progress in that. If we're 90% on time, once this goes in, I'd like to see 93% on time, or, you know, but those are the metrics that we'll be looking at to
And then on the other side of the house, FAST will be monitoring it to see what the impacts are on traffic flows, you know, per time interval as a consequence of this. And I think one of the reasons for having a more open-ended time frame on the valuation is there's so many possibilities for changing the configuration, and we don't necessarily know what changes we're going to have to make until we see what it looks like. So I would say you're probably looking at least 6 months. You know, the transit side is pretty straightforward, but how do we do this in a way that, and can we do it in a way that doesn't have worse negative impacts on regular traffic? Because obviously idling vehicles at an intersection creates undue air pollution. And so there's just, it's open-ended because there's so many things we got to consider.
And I would think you'd want to have it a little bit longer because there's seasonality.
Yeah.
That you would want to.
Yeah, seasonality, time of day, all of that is going to play, you know, play a role and you know.
Okay. So Nathan, will you come back when you have data from this to share with
me? Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Great.
Couple of things. I haven't read the NRS that covers this technology in a long time because we had the problem with citizens buying the technology. So basically, the legislature saw fit to outlaw it except for a select, very small select group of users, primarily emergency vehicles, addicted to that. I mean, so much so that AMR or Southwest can't use it. So my question is, how is the RTC getting around that law if it hasn't been changed?
My understanding is it's been changed and we have the authority to use that.
Okay. All right. Second suggestion. The one thing that I haven't heard anybody mention about monitoring in this process, because I have some concerns, is I suggest you talk to Metro and give Metro's Traffic Bureau the intersections that are going to be affected by this change, and ask them for the period of your study to monitor the crashes that occur there.
That's a great.
Do we see an increase? Do we see a decrease? Because there are a lot of people in this town that take the same route to and from every day, and they know at what time of day those signals are, and they time themselves accordingly. So changing the signals midstream is going to catch some people off guard that may unintentionally cause some side effects besides the air pollution and those kind of things. We don't want to cause more crashes than already out there. There's too many of those as it is now.
Because God forbid they should just pay attention to the damn signal. Yeah.
But, you know. Well, and this is going to have an effect on pedestrians because of the signals on the pedestrians. And 90 seconds sounds like a long time for a green light. It ain't. You know, those intersections that have 90-second intervals have very high traffic volumes.
So...
It won't override a pedestrian signal.
Yeah, the 90 seconds will still be 90 seconds.
If...
This might delay it.
It might delay it.
The 90 seconds you get.
It could shorten it, but I asked about that, and if there's a pedestrian signal request, it won't shorten it.
So, in other words, what you're saying is, we're such a low priority that pedestrians would get priority over the buses. If they pushed a signal and they're halfway through the signal, it's not suddenly going to take 2 seconds away from them.
Right. We don't want to leave somebody stuck in the median.
Right, yeah, no.
But I think we should be prepared, because once this gets out to the media, and the public understand it, they're going to say, well, I don't ride the bus, I don't care, like you said. And they're going to say, you're taking it away from me. And the first big crash that occurs, everybody's going to, so I think we need to be prepared for that.
I ride the bus, and one of the things I try to ask the people at the bus stop, whether they're security or the drivers or whomever, for some of their input, so I can bring it to the meeting. I don't know that everybody here rides the bus. Is there, do we collect data or opinions or whatever from the drivers themselves that are going to be affected? But I know they generally run the same route. I mean, you've got guys on that Flamingo route that have been there for years. Is there a way to get their input or their opinions on this?
Absolutely. There's a couple different ways that we do that. Obviously, there's the kind of the lower level ways that, you know, each of the contractors have comment boxes where the operators can fill out a form and tell us what they see. It actually works. We utilize those forms a great deal, whether it be to trim trees. I know your guys get those all the time, that the bus is hitting tree limbs on the street or whatever. It can be stuff like that, or it can be, you know, I had to wait through 2 cycles of a stoplight at this intersection, and can you check out the timing, things like that. So nobody knows their route like the drivers do, obviously. And then the other thing that we do is we meet, the RTC meets with a driver's focus group on a quarterly basis. So it's kind of it's just a gathering of what 30, 40, 50 operators a lot of times get together and voice, you know, their concerns and opinions on various things that we then are tasked with assisting with. But certainly the Flamingo operators will be made aware that, you know, that this is on their, they'll see the emitters in their window for sure anyway, but they'll be made aware that they have that capability.
Following up on something that Bill said, is there going to be any kind of public announcement or so that the public's aware that this is happening on that street? The drivers, to your point, they might be aware that signal timing may be affected?
I'm not entirely sure yet where we're at with that.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly what our government affairs team's plans are for that. And it's so, I don't know how to tell you if your time is going to be affected or what amount. So I don't know what kind of message we would deliver other than we're looking at something that'll be low impact to motorists that could have a positive impact on transit on time performance. So at some point, though, we are going to have to do some public dissemination and solicit some feedback from the motorists. Fortunately, we have the FAST team as part of the RTC, and they'll be doing daily real-time monitoring of the traffic impacts from a macro level. To give us that feedback.
Okay.
Thank you, Nathan.
Thank you.
Okay, so number 5 is to receive information regarding the RTC's new camera access on fixed wrap vehicles called Live Look-In.
So this is our LiveTrack system. As most of you will remember, a little bit more than a year ago, we had a shooting on one of our buses near Mandalay Bay. And because our windows are tinted, and on that particular bus we had advertising over the vinyl, it made it difficult to see into the buses from the side. So we have cameras on our buses. We have a wireless router on our buses that not only provides connectivity for the bus, but provides free Wi-Fi for our customers. So we hooked the two systems together, and this is what we got. These right now are all of our buses that are on the road. The blue ones are the buses operated by Keolis. The red ones are the buses operated by MV. And we have connected those systems in real time. And so this is a tool for law enforcement. I have access of it through the implementation phase, but once it's done, it'll be our safety and security, the operations companies themselves and law enforcement. So if they get a report of something going on to a bus, they can connect to this and actually see what's happening in real time. One of the challenges for the SWAT officers is they had a person on a bus with a gun. They didn't know who else was on the bus. Was somebody laying on the floor? And even if the windows were not tinted, you can't see on the floor from outside. So this gives them a lot better access to all of our cameras.
Boy, the things you never thought you were going to need to do, huh? Mm-hmm.
This one's my favorite view.
The outside. Yeah.
Just being able to see it as it goes down the road.
Yeah, too bad. We can't really use any of that except for, I mean, you know, if something happens, we can't use that video. You know, if some crash happens right in front of your bus and it's all, I can't use it. So. But
well,
then that's not your fault. That's
the video is recorded on the bus, so which our contractors own and maintain that video. So they have a whole process. They work with law enforcement to get them stuff after the fact.
Well, law enforcement can get it, but it's not admissible. That's, you know, because we have that law that says nothing's admissible if the camera wasn't in a police officer's hand.
Oh, I did
not
know that.
No, that's not true.
Yeah.
Photo enforcement?
Yeah. No. Oh, that you're not talking photo enforcement.
But I didn't think that, like,
That law specifically is talking about the signals on traffic lights.
But something like this, or something like the signals on...
You're talking about red light cameras.
Yeah, but totally I'm also different. Talking about the monitoring cameras, the fast cameras that monitor... I thought that none of that was admissible.
This isn't a fast camera. This is privately owned by the bus company.
We use those all the time.
Yeah, they're used all the time.
Video from
in civil and criminal cases.
It's equivalent to a surveillance camera at a
police
force.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, we use them.
Well, that's good.
Yes.
Is there any way that the drivers can be notified? Say, almost like instant replay in football. You're looking to see if a guy was in bounds and you see a guy committing a foul. Is there a way to kind of cover both and let the driver know there's somebody upstairs with a gun or laying on the floor or doing something? Is there two-way communication?
There is two-way communication on the bus. What the operations companies do with this video is really between them and their employees and their unions. RTC is not directly involved from law enforcement. Keep in mind, this is going through an existing network connection. When we have an emergency, there's nothing more important going on than the surveillance on the bus. But during normal operations, you know, we have fare collections through our mobile app. You know, so we've got other things going on with the Wi-Fi. It's not really intended to be something that people are going to sit there and monitor continuously, just because of the limits on available bandwidth. But obviously, when you've got an emergency or you have a genuine law enforcement need, I think one of the greatest things is, you know, the drivers all have a panic button. They have two-way communications. They report a problem on a bus. You can kind of look and see, even if the driver was cryptic or, you know, didn't really say anything, you can actually look and see what's going on in the bus. Is it something? Was it an accident? If law enforcement has to respond, they can, dispatch can look at it, or the SWAT folks can look at it, or Metro's Fusion Center, and say, you know, what's going on here? How do we respond? How do we want to respond? It gives them some intelligence to use. And we're hoping that that's going to be a good tool for them. We have signage on our buses as everyone gets on that lets them know they're under surveillance. So whether somebody's actually looking at that particular minute or not, it doesn't really matter. It is recorded and maintained for a period of time. So, and there is audio. There's a mic in each one of the cameras. If somebody's yelling, then you can distinguish what they're saying. But if they're not, you really can't hear. It's just, you know, background noise.
That's live right now?
Yes, it is.
So Carl, when that shooting happened, when the, you know, on Las Vegas Boulevard, didn't you eventually, it seems to, I seem to remember somewhere along the line, you didn't have this capability, but you eventually figured out in the middle of that how SWAT could see inside the bus by using it?
So all of our buses have a Wi-Fi radio on them, so when they come into the yard, they connect to our network. Any video that has been requested for download will download overnight while the bus is in the yard. We were in the field trying to make the bus think it was in the yard and give us access to the camera system before we could make that work, because we were justifiably so not as close to the bus as we normally would be.
Right.
The guy surrendered.
Oh, I just seem to remember something about.
Yeah, we were
trying to make.
We had a plan, and we were hacking into it before we could achieve that. It was. We didn't want to be in that position again. So.
Yeah, well, it's kind of sad, the things that we learn that we need. But
yeah.
Any other questions? Okay, so item number 6 on the agenda is again to conduct a comment period. So I'll go first to the committee members and see if there's anyone on the committee that wants to. So I have a question that just the lighting that you guys brought in, and is that, has that been?
We have 8 of those lights on the street, and I've forgotten. We presented 2.
Right.
We're going to get like 11 of each. And we've received 11 of the first one, and I think 8 of them are up, and I think we've received only 1 of the second one. And in the meantime, we have a third vendor who's approached us with their model, so we're going to try that out too.
Someone sent me a picture of a bus stop to show me how well lit it was.
Yay.
Just from a from a pedestrian standpoint. They had no idea that it had anything to do with the shelter, but when I saw this picture, I thought that has to be one of the lights. So great job, that's awesome.
Galleria just west of Boulder Highway, yep, is where the first two are at, by the water park.
Have you driven past it?
Yeah, every night, yep.
Yay.
That's great.
That's great,
yeah,
to hear.
Yeah, on Boulder Highway, a few of those would be awesome. Right. So terrific, that's just, when I saw that picture, I thought that has to be one of those, so. Yay. Okay, so if nobody else on the committee, if anybody in the audience would like to address the committee, this is public comment time. All right, seeing none. When's our next meeting? I don't have my calendar again. June 21st. So funny, it's
summer solstice.
I should just
June
put
21st.
It. Huh? 21st? All right, so we'll see you back here at 3 o'clock on the 21st of June. Thank you all for attending, and be careful out there.
Thank you.